Instagram is a bitch.
Going forward, the Naruto card game would be focusing primarily on the Shippuden anime, and with that comes a brand new look. This is one of the best decisions that Bandai ever made, and the game would keep this new look until the end of its lifespan. Let's take a look at some of the details. The most notable change is that all of the elemental signs have now been completely reworked. They're a lot more uniform now, all focusing on a circular design. Some people like this change, some people don't like this change. Personally, I love it. I think the new designs are fantastic. The fire symbol now actually looks like it's on fire. The earth symbol, while not necessarily being as unique, losing the fan design, still does have kind of a circular fan pinwheel design going to it. And even the more subtly changed lightning symbol has a much fuller design and looks a lot more complicated. Going forward, every card in the game has this nice golden border around them, but they retain the same color palette so you can still tell which cards are which types. I think this is a nice compromise. You can see that the cards are much more uniform, but you can also look at a glance and see how many of each card type you have in your hand. The turn and hand cost symbols are also changed slightly. The turn cost doesn't look too different from its old, but the hand cost is significantly different. Now, personally speaking, I like the old hand cost symbol better, old hand cost symbol supremacy, but I don't know, it's not a big enough change for me to really worry that much about it. Another very noticeable change is the background to the character cards. The old designs looked kind of busy. It didn't really seem like they had a good idea of what they wanted to do with the backgrounds, but the new ones look very, very clean, and I like the idea of including the symbol behind the character. There are some other minor changes, but you all have eyes. I'm sure you can see what they are. And before we get too far into the new sets, we need to give a moment of silence to some of the cards that we lost to the block format. Come to think of it, it might be more than just a moment of silence. I would highly recommend paying attention to this funeral scene because this is one of the most significant card losses that we ever got in Naruto history. So as you can see, the early game of Naruto CCG needed to adapt heavily to the changes that just happened. Like, we lost some of my personal favorite cards, one of them being Jiraiya Instruction of the Hidden Technique. That was my favorite card in the game up to this point, and even that doesn't compare to just how crazy the other changes were. The entire Inoshika Cho formation is gone now, and that includes Flexomaru, which really hurt mental decks. ADP Sakura is also gone. Power of Youth is gone, so Youth of the Nation decks are also gone. Tamari is gone, so you can no longer look at your opponent's hand and get rid of a Jutsu card, and so is her Jutsu Gigantic Fan, so getting rid of Jutsu Spam is going to be a lot more difficult in the new set. Lightning lost both Gamabunta and the Naruto Gamabunta Platoon, as well as the Asuma Shikamaru Platoon. So this is going to be a significantly different metagame for those who have been following the game for a while. Of course, most sets incorporate one of the movies or filler arcs for a little bit of fun and variety, and the one we get here is the third Naruto movie, which focuses on the Land of Moon. Now, I just gotta say, man to man, If you've never seen this movie, if you're the kind of person who skipped all the Naruto filler and you skipped all of the movies and you didn't really get into the outer Naruto universe, this is actually a pretty decent movie. I'd recommend you check it out. The ending is superb, and the Moonlight Rasengan is one of my favorite Naruto Rasengan moments in the entire show, but I digress. The reason that any of this is important is there was a new client released called Michiru Suki, and he went on to become one of the core staples of the new metagame. At the beginning of your turn, if you are turn marker 5 or higher, you can discard a chakra to draw a card. This is a permanent effect that you get every single turn for the rest of the game. Fantastic. Since there was nothing color specific about this effect, he was used in literally every single competitive deck at the time, the only exception being if you already had a client that you were very focused on, but that almost never happened. If for whatever reason your deck could not handle using Michiru, maybe you needed that chakra for some jutsu spam or something, Shabadaba was... I'm sorry, I can't say that name without laughing. Shabadaba was your other go-to client because his entire purpose is just to make sure your opponent doesn't get to play with a client card. So either you played with Michiru or you made sure your opponent didn't play with Michiru. There was a hypothetical world where some people played with Hikaru, specifically this one, if they were using a deck that focused on promise coins, but I'll be real, most of the promise cards weren't really that meta-defining, so I'm going to skip most of that for right now. Just know that it existed, and this was a fringe rogue pick that you would see once in a while. To go along with Michiru, we've got a new Naruto that you would be running. If you don't have a Prince client in play, you can search for one in your deck and put it in your hand. Everybody ran this Naruto to make sure that they could get their Prince in play on time. And the great thing about this Naruto is he gets clone status while you have that Michiru in play, so you can still use your jutsu just like normal. Sakura also got a Land of Moon specific card that let you draw if you had Michiru in play and was also a 2-2 as long as that card was in play, so you could hypothetically run a stronger Prince lineup, and Sakura and Naruto were two of the cards that you would use to achieve this effect. But for the most part, you always used the new Naruto and Sakura because you had lost so much with the loss of your Inoshika Cho formation. A slightly more consistent version of the old Legacy of the Fourth Hokage Naruto is Konohamaru, who now let you draw a card and then move a card from your hand to the bottom of the deck when put in play. This was fantastic for most Toad decks at the time because if you were able to put a good Ninja Toad on the bottom of your deck, then you could use an effect to pull that card out from the bottom of your deck and put it in play, making that strategy a lot more consistent. But even regular decks were running Konohamaru in their main lineup, since the effect also triggered off of growth, and when you growth this in play, it's a 3-1, which is not bad. In addition to the Land of Moon stuff, we also got the, I can't even remember, star, comet, piece of the meteorite, whatever thing. It's really not that important, but Mizura was a fairly decent ninja to use as well if you were trying to get through the early game as quickly as possible. Basically, when this card goes out to battle, it injures itself, but when it dies, you get to draw a card. A lot of the later game is about culling your opponent's turn 0 and turn 1 ninjas, which is something that will become a theme in future sets. There are lots and lots of cards that specifically get rid of your opponent's early game cards, so you can't rely on them as heavily as you could in previous sets. Having a card kill itself to let you draw a card is actually a fairly decent effect. Now, if you're just reeling over the loss of ADP Sakura, they did end up turning her effect into a jutsu card, which is, I'll admit, significantly worse because you're going minus one by having to actually play this card from your hand instead of just having it in play all the time. But if you just really needed that ADP Sakura effect to get the top cards of your deck, you could use this. However, something else that makes it significantly worse is the fact that you have to shuffle your deck afterwards. So You could redraw your hand if you want to, but you can't choose what card your opponent is taking as their battle rewards, which I guess is fair, but is going to be felt going into the new metagame. With all these changes going on, you'd think there's very little left to talk about before we start getting into the actual cards, but you would be wrong. There was a brand new mechanic even released with the new set. This mechanic would be known as Ambush, and it essentially let you play characters that were in your chakra area. Water would be the premier set to feature these Ambush characters, so I guess we'll look at Water first. The number one new water staple would be Kisame Hoshigaki, just a fantastic card for controlling your chakra area and your opponent's chakra area while you're at it. During your mission phase, if you have 3 or less chakra, you can take a water card from your discard pile and put it in your chakra area. The reason this is so important is not just because you can get more chakra for your jutsu, but also this lets you put more ambush characters into your chakra area to then be played. Keep this effect in mind going forward, because that is the primary way you're going to have to get some of these characters in play. Then at the end of your turn, if your opponent has 3 or more chakra, you can get rid of one of those cards. Since you're the one discarding your opponent's chakra, this lets you counter your opponent's ambush by getting rid of their ambush characters, or it lets you control which chakra your opponent has access to if you know what kind of jutsu they're probably running. The new Haku and Zabuza are nowhere. First of all, this Haku is nowhere near as good as the Haku we lost, which hurts a lot, but during the exchange of jutsu, you can discard this ninja to make sure one of your other ninjas does not receive damage for the turn. There's a couple of really great things about this effect. First of all, this character doesn't even have to be in the battlefield for this effect to take place, which is a lot more useful than you would think it would be, okay? Try and keep this in mind for the next set. Zabuza, on the other hand, is quite a step up from some of the Zabuzas that we've had before, and he would only get more and more powerful as the game went on. If Zabuza attacks while injured, he heals himself, and he's a +1/+1 as long as he's in the same team as Haku. So a 7-3 with infinite healing, again, as good as that seems now, it's nothing compared to how good it's about to get, so try and keep this card in your head going forward. Of course, you can't have a sneaky new effect like this without Orochimaru slithering his way in there, so we also got an Orochimaru with Ambush. He got himself a new effect called Presence, which is an effect that all 3 of the Sanin would get, but Orochimaru wore it the best as usual. He cannot be blocked by your opponent's team if it has a ninja of entrance cost 2 or less. You know, if Orochimaru's there, Kabuto's probably there too. A new Kabuto with Ambush also came out, and his effect basically protected Orochimaru, but we'll pretend it's also useful for other characters. I suppose Zabuza also benefits from this effect too. Him and anybody else in his team with an entrance cost of 5 or more, Kabuto's a bit of a size queen, do not receive damage by your opponent's effects. Let me simplify that for you. Your opponent's Kidomaru and Spider-Bow Fierce Rip did not work in Kabuto's team. Actually, speaking of which, oh my gosh. Oh, the Sound 4. Oh my gosh, I hope we got new Sound 4 ninjas with Ambush. That would be so sick. Oh well. Karma's a bitch. What did you do? This ninja cannot be charged from your hand. But That's the entire way you get them into your chakra area. I don't want to have to jump through hoops to get these guys into the chakra area. When this ninja is deployed by the effect of Ambush, place a Ninja Blade coin symbolizing State 2 on it. While this ninja has a State 2 coin on it, this ninja gets State 2. Oh, well, good for you. So what does this do for me exactly? Is this just so they can use their old jutsu cards from before? That's pathetic. Oh, this card is awful. All of them are awful. The only one that's even remotely playable is to Yuya, and that's because her stats are essentially Kurenai's stats. And of course, since the new Sound 4's ambush mechanic is so awful, we need to find ways to get them into the chakra area. So let's take a look at the new Choji. When it's sent out to attack, you can put the top card of your deck into the chakra area, and you get +1. So he's a 3 for the turn. I guess that's an acceptable way to try and get these guys into the chakra area. Not that you should be using them, but unfortunately we are reaching the lifespan of our state 2 boys and girls, so at some point we're going to be stuck with these guys. And if you want to get them in to the chakra area to ambush them, I suppose this is an option that you have. Ambitious squad, put one ninja in your chakra area. With the sound 4 plus ambush plus an interest cost of 3 into play, gosh dang it, that is not even useful for getting them into the chakra area. If they already have ambush, this effect is basically useless. All it does is let you get out an extra deploy for the turn, which, don't get me wrong, that's fine, but I wish... Why doesn't it do anything to get them into the chakra area first? I can't charge them. And I just want to get this out of the way. Using a card from your hand to pay the hand cost of another card is also considered charging. So if your idea around getting around this effect is just to use them to pay for a mission card like this one, that ain't gonna work. You can't use them to pay for hand costs. How awful. The ones moving in the dark, move one ninja card with ambush in your discard pile to your chakra area. Well, you ask silly questions and you get silly answers, I suppose. Yes, that is technically a way that you could get those cards into the chakra area a little bit more easily. So basically, the plan is to use ones moving in the dark and Kisame's effect and probably sometimes Choji's effect to get those cards into the chakra area, and then maybe use their mission card to play 2 of them in a single turn. I hope this isn't the future of the Sound 4. On slightly happier news, Zabuza and Haku got themselves their own little mission card, which basically just let you search for one of them and put them into your hand. Not too bad of a card, probably very useful in the sets to come, because Zabuza and Haku would become staples that you would use in pretty much every water deck. And one more card I wanted to look at while we're talking about the ambush characters, Orochimaru in particular, is New Vessel, which let you take the effect text of one of your characters in the chakra area and give it to Orochimaru. Here's where the effect gets interesting. The character that you choose has to have an entrance cost of 4 or less. And guess who has an entrance cost of 4 or less? This was a way that you could get Kitamaru's effect in play twice. What a sick card. Another kind of neat thing about this card is it doesn't specify that it has to be a water ninja, so there were other characters and other elements that you could use this card with. Lots of cheesy interactions. You could definitely turn this into a very fun, gimmicky type of deck, but I'm going to focus on its meta relevance, and its meta relevance was the Sound 4 effects onto Orochimaru. One last thing about this card before we move on from it. You don't even have to only have one of these in play. You could play 3 New Vessels and have Kitamaru, Tuyuya, and Jirobo's effect all in play on Orochimaru, while also having Kitamaru, Tuyuya, and Jirobo in play. What a great card. Temporizing Threat was a way to either keep your opponent from attacking you for a couple of turns, or get you to draw a couple more cards. You could choose one of your opponent's ninjas. If that ninja sent out to battle, you get to draw a card. This works both for attacking and blocking, so if you wanted to, you could choose one of your opponent's best blockers and make it so they had to give you a card every time they sent that ninja out to block as well. Vision of the Future, very simple card, just call out a card name, and in 2 turns, you get to pull that card from your deck and put it in your hand. This was a very sad card to play if your card that you were looking for happens to be in your battle reward area, but as long as that wasn't the case, this was normally just a straight-up tutor that gave you anything in your deck. And Water really only got one noticeably good jutsu, but dang, was it a noticeably good jutsu. New Water Dragon Jutsu let you pay X amount of chakra to flip that many coins and then give one damage to a ninja for the amount of heads that you get. That effect itself is pretty terrible, but the fact that the card always changes one ninja in play to injured status was extremely good. 8 out of 10 times when you played this card, you were paying zero for X. You just wanted to pay that one water chakra to turn one ninja into injured status. This would invalidate its effect, ruin its stats, and ruin your opponent's day at the same time. Since it's one ninja and not one ninja battling against the user, this was even great if you sent your teams out to attack and your opponent didn't block one of your teams. You could still ruin their field without them ever interacting with you. And I suppose those 2 out of 10 times, you could pay a little bit of chakra to try and get rid of one of your opponent's characters. Whatever. Now, I'm going to tell you about a super secret spicy tech that your boy Kudo ran around this time. I know this isn't really like a quote-unquote meta card, but hear me out, okay? Trust your boy Kudo for a second. The Kettoine clan had this character named Agati Kaisen, and his effect let you basically name him something on your opponent's side of the board. So if your opponent had a Sasuke in play, this card was named Sasuke. If your opponent had a Shikamaru in play, this card was named Shikamaru, so on and so forth. But why does that matter, Kudo? Well, it's okay. I'll feed you baby birds. So first things first, he had his own jutsu called Face Copying Jutsu, which let you return one of your opponent's ninjas with the same name as his name to their hand. One of the main advantages that this gives us is if your opponent is running like a Gaara over 9000 deck or some kind of jutsu spam deck like Rasengan, then you can call him Gaara or Naruto, and then during battle, if your opponent tries to play a jutsu, you can use Face Copying Jutsu to return that character to your opponent's hand, and then the effect fizzles. The other great thing about this card is it doesn't have to be a character fighting against you, it just has to be a character in play. So if you really wanted to, if your opponent was running a platoon of some kind, you could get rid of that platoon using this effect and then make it much more difficult for that character to come back into play. Now here's where we put the burner on high mode. This also meant that you could platoon him into a character that your opponent had on their side of the field. So if you were in the mirror match and your opponent just so happens to have a Naruto in play, for example, you could name him Naruto and then platoon into a character that needed Naruto. It's such a great sideswipe. Your opponent never sees this coming. I was the only person in my area who actually cared about this card. I'm sure other people around the country also figured this strategy out, and if you did, you're my brother forever. He was definitely my sleeper hit of the entire set. Speaking of which, just so you don't think I'm a crazy person, let's go ahead and look at Lightning next. With the loss of our old Naruto Gamabunta platoon, we did end up getting a brand new one, and this one is much, much better. He's not affected by the effects of your opponent's ninja or jutsu cards. Once again, more Kidomaru hate. And whenever he's sent out to battle, you can put the top card of your deck into the chakra area. Now, this sounds like a fairly familiar effect. I wonder why this is good. Oh yeah, it's because he has a water symbol, and you can run him in a water deck to put more ambushed characters into your chakra area. So while a lot less common, you could, hypothetically, run this in a water ambush deck in order to get more characters into your chakra area. If you weren't running an ambush style deck, then this card came in and completely overshadowed Naruto and the Naruto Gamabunta platoon, because his effect basically just removed one of your opponent's characters from the game completely by putting it on the bottom of the deck. Unless it's a very specific circumstance, this card's always going to be better than running the Gamabunta and Naruto platoon, although I do admit trying to get Gamabunta or the fourth Hokage out and then having to lose one of them is a little bit worse than just having Naruto Gamabunta and a fourth Hokage in play. While we're on the topic of platoons, though, they came out with a fairly clever platoon, if I'm being honest. Naruto and a shadow clone could be a platoon. What's his effect? Built-in Shu the Cat, of course. So your Rasengans can cost one lightning, just like the good old days. One important note about this, though, is you'll notice it says a jutsu card that includes Rasengan in its name. I wonder why they're being that specific about its effect. A couple of just genuinely good Narutos also came out in the set. We'll start by looking at Insensitive. This ninja's team and the team battling against it cannot perform a missile power battle. This is basically your best counter to your opponent's mental power decks, although admittedly, those are dying out a little bit, so a little less useful than it normally would have been, but if your opponent is still running mental power in this day and age, this is your best way to get around it. And since he doesn't require a hand cost, this could be a staple in every deck going forward. Pretty good card, but pales in comparison to the secret rare Naruto we got, Growing Power. When this ninja sent out to battle, you can discard a chakra, and then if you win the battle, you get a battle reward. This card is basically the return of the old Kakashi we had back in Revenge and Rebirth, but a little bit better because you didn't lose anything if you happened to lose the battle. Finally, we've got a Jiraiya. He has the exact same effect as the Orochimaru we looked at before. Still a decent include, but unfortunately, he doesn't really have any of the great things that Orochimaru has. He doesn't have the ambush, he doesn't have the mental power, but if you are running a Rasengan deck, he can use Rasengans all day long, so you might as well include him. Speaking of using Rasengans, Rasengan! One ninja battle against the user, give one damage to the target. If the target is discarded due to the damage from this jutsu card, give one damage to one of your opponent's ninjas. A somewhat decent card, though keep in mind, at this point in the game, the good Rasengan is still very playable, so I'd recommend playing that one over this one. But enough of Rasengan, let's look at a completely different card called Explosion of the Rasengan. What a clever way to run more than three Rasengans in your deck. Just call them something different. This is why it's important going forward that cards referencing Rasengan just say Rasengan in its name, because you can basically run a full jutsu lineup of nothing but Rasengan cards going forward. That's awesome. But is it any good? Well, you can take one of your opponent's ninjas battling against you and move it to the bottom of the deck, so I don't know, you tell me. Yes, obviously it's good. It is the fourth Hokage and Gamabunta effect on a spammable jutsu. But of course, if we're going to look at Rasengans in this set, we have to look at the Moonlight Rasengan. Yes, baby, it's coming back. It was an awesome moment in the movie, and it's going to be an awesome card in the game. Not only do you get the +7 buff that you normally do, but if you win a victory or an outstanding victory, you get to win one battle reward, and if your Michiru is in play, it becomes two battle rewards. So let me just simmer it down a little bit. If you have your other secret rare Naruto in play, and he plays the Moonlight Rasengan, and you use his effect, then this is potentially three battle rewards off of winning a battle. That is so good. I love Moonlight Rasengan to death. The Naruto love continues with a harem jutsu. Obviously. As always, Naruto turns into a female, and your opponent's male ninjas add their team power to your team instead of your opponent's team. This almost always guarantees that you are going to get an outstanding victory during the turn that this is put into play. It's also a great counter to anything that would have given your opponent any kind of steroid or buff for the turn. Phantom Jutsu was a more of a sideboard card, but it still saw a lot of competitive play. It basically let you skip the showdown for one turn, so it didn't do anything to your opponent's jutsus. Your opponent could still jutsu you down to death. It didn't do anything to ninja effects necessarily, but if you needed to stall for a turn or if your opponent played something that made your board useless for one turn, there are no showdowns. Whatever your opponent did to your side of the board would be erased during the next turn. It's a fairly decent sideboard card, but you would never see it in somebody's main deck. And then the last card I want to look at here in the Rasengan package is Exercise. You can choose one of your Genin ninjas and put a growth coin on it. The thing that makes this important is it doesn't have to just be a normal ninja. It can be a platooned ninja. So, for example, if you have a Naruto Gamabunta platoon in play, then you can use this card to put growth coins on it. Another notable thing about this card is since it doesn't say another ninja, it can just be the character that plays this card. So since this has to be played by a Jonin, if you have a Jonin and Genin platoon in play, then they can use this card to give themselves one growth coin. Overall, not too bad of a card if you're using it in the right strategy. With all of this Rasengan love going around, you'd almost think that Lee got left out, but he didn't. The Lee cards that came out were also extremely good. The new Might Guy let you search your deck for a mission card called Hot-Blooded Tuition. Well, what does Hot-Blooded Tuition do? If you have either Rock Lee or Might Guy in play, then you and your opponent look at each other's hands and they get rid of all of your jutsus. But if you have both Rock Lee and Might Guy in play, only your opponent reveals their hands and gets rid of their jutsus. Of course, just getting to look at your opponent's hand is pretty preem, but getting to get rid of all of your opponent's jutsus before you launch in with a big attack is just fantastic. Rock Lee and Might Guy also got the 8 inner gates. You can give 2 damage to one ninja battling against you, and then 1 damage to the user. For something that costs 3 random chakra, that is a really great effect. Not only is this essentially jutsu removal, because you can give the 2 damage to a ninja that's currently using a jutsu, but this basically kills a ninja, then gives 1 damage to your side of the board that you can easily get rid of through other effects. Lotus Chain, get +5/+0, and if you win a victory or an outstanding victory, then you can take one of the cards from your opponent's hand and put it into your battle rewards. Not only does your opponent get rid of a card from their hands, but you get one battle reward. Sign me up. Then finally, they got Double Dynamic Entry. If you happen to have either Rock Lee or Might Guy in play, then you can take one of the ninja battling against you and put it on top of your opponent's deck. But if you have both of them in play, then you take your opponent's entire team and put them back on top of the deck. Who knew that Rock Lee would become the face of removal? And in Lightning? That's crazy. Really, Fire was the only other element that had that much interesting stuff going on, so I guess we'll go ahead and look at that next. Let's just get the obligatory Uchiha stuff out of the way with Sasuke. A turn 3 ninja with somewhat decent stats. During the exchange of jutsu, you could get rid of 2 cards from your hand to negate 1 jutsu card being played. He's alright. Basically an emergency oh no button if your opponent has Explosion of the Rasengan on their board. Itachi got a little bit more love with his secret rare. You could discard a chakra to remove him and one of your opponent's ninjas from the battlefield and turn them into standby ninjas. Not only was this a great combo starter for some cards that we'll see a little bit later, but it was also great for just getting rid of your opponent's jutsus. Once again, if your opponent's character is not in the battlefield, they cannot use jutsu, so for 1 chakra and the loss of some stats, you could make your opponent's jutsu fizzle. Sasuke and Orochimaru was also a brand new platoon you could play. When your turn marker becomes 9, you can take one of your opponent's in play ninjas and put it on the bottom of the deck. Yes, this is another instance of the 4th Hokage and Gamabunta platoon's effect. One kind of neat thing about this is it can be repeated, so as soon as this effect is applied, you can discard 2 cards from your hand to move your turn marker down by 1, making it so that your next turn rolls around, your turn marker becomes 9, and you can do this effect all over again. This effect can then repeat pretty much every single turn until you choose not to do it and your turn marker goes to 10 or above. You basically had to run this card if you were running Sasuke or Orochimaru in your deck, but it very rarely came down to repeating this effect over and over again and constantly getting to apply its effect. Usually you got its effect off maybe twice in one game, and that was the deciding factor. Bit of an off-color pick, we've got Hayate as well. He essentially has like a baby version of the presence effect that the Sanin all got. He cannot be blocked by a ninja with an entrance cost of one or less if it's in a team by itself. So you could include him in a team, and then your opponent's meat puppet options became a little bit more useless since they had to choose a meat puppet that was at least two entrance costs or more. Fire Style Fireball Jutsu is just a very interestingly designed card. It can be used by anybody. It gives one damage to any ninja on the field, and its only real downside is if you happen to choose somebody with a flame combat attribute, which is very rare, by the way, then you also have to take one damage. So, a really good card. I think it's a lot better than they even expected it to be. The only real Uchiha jutsu we got was, once again, called Kaleidoscope Sharingan. Not Mangekyo, but I digress. Of course, if a Kaleidoscope Sharingan card comes out, only Itachi is going to be using it. It affects every ninja battling against you. You reveal the top card of your deck at the same time as your opponent, and if they happen to be the exact same card's type, then all of your opponent's ninjas battling against you take one damage. Interesting thing about this card is just how little the cost is. You pay one fire chakra, and you have a chance of dealing three damage to your opponent's side of the board. This is another one of those cards that, for the time being, is just kind of mid, but going forward is going to see a lot more competitive play. Honestly, this set didn't give the Uchiha very many toys to play with, but the toy it did get to play with was fantastic. All of your in-play Uchiha get +1/+1, and any ninja cards with Uchiha in their name in your hand get -1 entrance cost. Really, there's only one more notable card we have to look at here, and that's Purchasing a Whole Circus. During your main phase, you can discard three cards from your hands to win a battle reward. Not necessarily the most consistent win condition, but if you happen to be stuck on 8 battle rewards, the great thing about an effect like this is you don't have to worry about sending ninjas out to battle, you don't have to worry about your opponent's jutsu cards or any kind of interaction at all, really. It's just eventually you have a win condition that will win you the game if your opponent doesn't win the game first. Now, believe it or not, despite the fact that we're done looking at Uchiha cards, we still have quite a lot to look at in Fire. Fire was starting to experiment further with the concept of animals milling cards from your opponent's deck. Not only did the animals get better, but the entire mill strategy got better as well. Most of the new strategy revolved around Tunneling Fang. You paid as many chakra as you wanted, and then for every heads you get on a coin flip, you could discard the top three cards of your opponent's deck. Then after you've done all of your coin flips, they discard another card from the top of their deck for every animal character you have in your team. So guaranteed, if you were running a team of three animals, this card got rid of at least three cards from your opponent's deck, and then if you were willing to fork out 5, 6 maybe chakra, then you were able to get rid of another 9 or 12 cards. While obviously having to flip coins isn't great, this is a pretty decent tool in addition to the other tools that animals already had. And of course, if you're going to run this strategy, you're going to need some more animals to play with. Luckily for you, the third Naruto movie involves an entire circus of them. Cham is an example of one of the animals you'll be using because he's got fairly decent stats, although the fact that he can't be the user of jutsu cards does hurt his playability just a little bit. And also, since chances are you won't be playing with Hikaru and you'll be using Michiru instead, he is going to come out on turn 2 instead of turn 1. But this does give you another animal to use for your strategy, and there are going to be other animals in the circus that you can include. Akamaru will turn himself and Kiba into 2-2s as long as you have both of them in play. And as long as they're in the same team with one another, they can't be affected by your opponent's ninja effects. At this point, you still want to be using the Kiba from the previous set, but this is the new Akamaru you want to be running. The new mission card, Communication, is how you'd be getting most of your circus animals in play, because you could search your deck for either a circus animal or a Land of Moon client card and put it into your hand, and then as long as this mission card is in your chakra area, all of your circus animals get +1/+1. This is the primary reason that circus animals were good for your mill strategy, since they could be searched from your deck with this mission card, and they also got a little bit of a power boost while in play. The only unfortunate thing about this card is at some point you are probably going to get rid of it for your Tunneling Fangs. The last animal-specific card I want to look at is Tracking by Ninja Hounds. You could essentially show your opponent a ninja dog from your hand and then shuffle it into your deck to draw three cards. This isn't really going plus. You're essentially breaking even, but you are going to have two more chakra to play with when Tunneling Fangs comes around. Now, as good as the animals were for this strategy, they aren't the primary reason that these decks were seeing play. There were a lot of cards that came out in this set that slowed the game down significantly and made it harder for you and your opponent to play. One of those examples is Hell Valley. Ninjas that are sent out to battle as the head ninja get one damage at the end of the turn, and this effect cannot be duplicated. Essentially, this made it so that there were turns where you and your opponent were not sending ninjas out to attack. And if you were running a mill strategy, this was perfect for you. You didn't want to be the one aggressing on your opponent and sending ninjas out to attack. You wanted your opponent to eventually lose the game by running out of cards from their deck. So there were a lot of turns where you were completely fine with not attacking and just passing the turn over to your opponent, and then they would normally be worried about attacking into you because they didn't want to lose their ninjas from Hell Valley. Honestly, there were a lot of very creative ways to use this card, but I think the mill strategy is the one that got the most use out of it because they were the ones who wanted to attack the least out of all of the meta competitive decks. In addition to Hell Valley, you also got Affected Body. So now, not only were you giving one damage to each of your head ninjas that went out to battle, but you were also having to discard a card from the top of your deck each time you sent a team out to battle. Once again, if your opponent was playing a typical deck, this is going to be something that just speeds up your mill strategy and makes it even easier for you to win, because they are going to have significantly less cards to play with than you are. Speaking of which, Melee was another really great card for this kind of strategy. You take your hand, put it in the chakra area, then draw the same amount of cards, and your opponent does the same. If your opponent is not attacking, and they are just passing turns and letting their hand build up, then there are some times where you can just get them to move six cards to their chakra area and draw six cards, which basically has the exact same effect as making them mill six cards. And of course, you can come out ahead in this interaction, because if you're moving all those cards to the chakra area, that's going to be an even bigger Tunneling Fang later in the game. If you wanted to lean really heavily into the strategy, there were also some ways that you could kind of slowly pick off your opponent's side of the board to make it harder to play around cards like Hell Valley. Left Alone was one of those. So at the end of your turn, you give one damage to every ninja in a team of only one ninja. And Browbeater kind of did the same thing, but a little bit more powerful. You give one damage to every single ninja with an entrance cost of three or less. Normally, this wasn't as good for you because a lot of your good ninjas were actually of a lower turn count. The circus animals, Kiba Nakamaru, all very, very low turn count ninjas. But if your opponent's board was getting a little bit big and you had a hard time dealing with it, a Browbeater or two is going to just clear the board so that you can continue to wait out your opponent and eventually win the Battle of Attrition. The last thing that tied this entire package together was the strategy of not going out to attack. Obviously, if you were running around playing cards like Hell Valley, not attacking, and Affected Body, and not attacking, then you're going to need to do something during your turns to actually benefit from the fact that you weren't sending ninjas out to battle. Naruto and Rock Lee was one of those ways. At the end of your turn, if you don't move Naruto and Rock Lee out to the battlefield, then they get a growth coin, and this can happen up to three times. So eventually this card will become a 7-3, and that's just really good for a team of Genin. In addition to this, you also have Remarkable Growth. You can choose one of your Genin, and every turn it's not sent out to battle, it gets one growth coin, but you cannot use this on a ninja that already has three growth coins on it. Basically, when your entire strategy is just making the game as long as possible, giving your opponent as many incentives not to attack you and just to end their turn without doing anything meaningful on their turns is going to be your bread and butter for how you actually win with a strategy like this. Well, as we start winding things down here, we've really only got Earth and Winds to look at, and unfortunately, neither of those elements got very much in this set, but we'll take a quick look at them. I guess we'll go ahead and start with Earth because it got one of the most unique cards in Ambush. This basically gave all of your Earth ninjas the effect of Ambush. This was even sneakier than the way that Water did Ambush, because this was impossible to predict. As soon as you wanted a ninja back from your chakra area, you dropped Ambush and that ninja came back. Going forward, Earth would be the other element to benefit heavily from Ambush ninjas. For right now, this is really all you get, but it is a fun way to give your Hyuga ninjas Ambush. Speaking of which, Power of the Byakugan, look at the top 5 cards of your opponent's deck and discard one of them. Hypothetically speaking, you could also use this in your mill deck, but paying 1 to mill 1 really isn't that good. It's normally just a way to get rid of one of your opponent's main centerpieces. We also hypothetically got another Battle Jutsu in 128 Palms, which is... Like, don't get me wrong, I want to love this card, but it really isn't that good. You flip 4 coins, and for every heads, you get to deal 1 damage to one of the ninja battling against you. But Kudo, doesn't it say every ninja battling against the user is the target, so doesn't it give 1 damage to all of them? Nope, because the effect clarifies that it's any one of the targets for each heads, so... The absolute best you could possibly do with this card is injuring every single ninja battling against you and then choosing one of them to discard. It's not awful. It's just, like, you're flipping 4 coins, man. Like, you can't expect that much out of this card. Earth really only got one other notable card, and that was Oath of Tears. Essentially, this was like... You know, when you're playing a Sonic the Hedgehog game and you hit the little TV box that has a picture of Sonic on it, that's basically what this card is. While this card is in play, if one of your ninjas is discarded due to the showdown, you can put this card in the chakra area to put that character back in play and place 1 growth coin on it. Now, obviously, this is a fantastic card. Not only do you get your ninja back, but it comes back with +1/+1, and there are no restrictions on which character you bring back. So if that character just so happens to be a platoon, for example, then you can bring back that platooned card with 1 growth coin on it. Like, what do you really say about a card like this? It's a 1 extra life. It's a green mushroom for your deck. Who doesn't want something like that? I guess if you twisted my arm, there was one more... somewhat unique thing going on in Earth in substitution jutsu. You take 1 ninja, you put it in the chakra area, then you take 1 ninja from your chakra area with an entrance cost equal to or less than the original ninja, and you put it in the original ninja spot in healthy status. There were some niche uses for this, one of them being that you could hypothetically heal a ninja by doing this. You could also use this with a ninja that you stole, though there weren't that many good stealing effects around this time. The only one I can really even think of is Kunihisa, which is another filler character, so don't worry if you're wondering why you've never heard of them before. He uses money-style jutsu, which I always got a kick out of. If you have 6 cards in your hand, you can discard 2 of them to take one of your opponent's in-play ninjas with an entrance cost of 2 or less and move it to your side of the village. Once again, there were some very interesting things you could do with an effect like this. Like, if you stole a platoon target, then they never got their card back. If you stole a character and then substitution jutsued it out, then once again, they don't get their card back. There are ways to play around a strategy like this, but again, it's so ridiculously niche that it did not see much, if any, competitive viable play. Of course, our last Sanin, Tsunade, also got the presence effects, which is, don't get me wrong, it's fantastic on Tsunade, especially with her mental power and the fact that she's a female medical ninja, which will become relevant in a set or two. Shizune became the best healer in the entire game, because as long as you didn't send her out to battle, you could discard the top card of your deck to heal a ninja every single turn if you chose. This was also another really great way to play around Hell's Valley. Sakura is another character that would become very valuable for female medical decks. It was a 4-3, but when you sent it out to battle, you could get rid of a chakra to have it lose all of its support stats and become a 6-0 instead. And since the female ninjas don't tend to have very good combats outside of Tsunade, this was basically a great way to stall until your Tsunade came into play. Wind got itself a pretty cheesy little mission card in Restart. This is the type of card that you see in pretty much every single card game, and Wind just so happened to be the element that got it in this game. You get rid of all the cards in your hand and all the cards in your chakra area, and then you get to take one additional turn after this turn is over. Again, there are some niche uses for a card like this. It's definitely going to win you some games, but it's not the kind of card that you would see in competitive viable decks that often unless it was in their sideboard. The last card Wind really got at all was Binding Destiny, which again wasn't even really a mainboard card. Each player shuffles all the cards from their discard pile back into their deck, which saw some play against your opponent's mill strategies. Gotta be honest, for how exciting the first half of this set was, it's kinda sad that it's going out on a whimper instead of a bang. Oh well, what can you do? I guess Wind just sucks. I guess Wind will just never be good again. I'm sure absolutely nobody will want to play Wind in the sets to come.